Hello, Patrick Walchuk here, and I'm sitting with Eric Fabien of the OttawaMortgageShop.com, and what we want to do is have a discussion about mortgages. Mortgages are something that I'm involved with purchasers, as is Eric, and buyers want to get a mortgage, And then when you get the bloody thing, you say, oh my God, I got to pay my mortgage. So we love to hate mortgages, but what the heck are they? Who determines these things? What makes them go up? What makes them go down? So this is more of kind of a back-end financial discussion about mortgages. So if you're interested in why your rates are going up or down, then this is a movie that is for you. So to start with, Eric, who determines a mortgage rate?
It's a good question. The Bank of Canada has a big play into deciding the mortgage rates. Obviously, it's at the bank's discretion as to how much profit they want to make off of that that percentage that the Bank of Canada introduces. But the Bank of Canada has the final say as to what happens to your rates. Obviously, the Bank of Canada is going to look at different things in order to decide if they're going to be increasing or decreasing rates, such as global economy, economy in Canada, and so on and so forth.
Okay, so you're saying the Bank of Canada determines mortgage rates. I've heard that there's these things called bonds, and bonds determine mortgage rates, so I'm confused.
The Bank of Canada has the final say. They will be looking at the bond market in order to make their decisions. The bond market is very sensitive and is very proactive when it comes down to inflation. So they're gonna sort of see into the future of what the inflation is gonna look like, and that will give you an idea as to if the bond's gonna go up or down. Typically, when you're looking at a bond market, if the bond goes up, the yield will go down, meaning that your interest rate will go up as well. So if you're looking at the bond market and you're seeing an increase, don't be surprised if your interest rate goes up.
Okay, so the interest you get charged in your mortgage is directly related to bonds.
Correct.
Okay.
It's not the only thing.
Okay.
Bonds are one of the things that influence. Obviously, you know, the economy plays a big factor into that as well. But the bond market is definitely one of them.
Okay. What the heck's a bond market?
It's a great question. So the bond market is it's made of seven different layers. The main one that's interested for us is the treasury bond, which is related directly into the government bond, which dictates exactly what the interest rates are going to be. Anybody can just invest into these types of bonds. Mainly high corporations are the ones that are investing in these bonds. Now, bonds, when you're purchasing bonds, it's a very low risk investment. Depending on which type of bonds that you go with, obviously high risk to low risk, but usually there's profit to be made out of bonds, very low risk as opposed to a mortgage, which is extremely high risk.
Okay, so once again, you mentioned inflation. So we're maybe at the very beginning of an inflationary period. As inflation creeps up, what's going to happen to bonds again?
They're going to go up.
So when bonds go up, your mortgage is going to go up.
The mortgage payments,
okay,
yeah, mortgage and interest rate.
Okay, great. So for you people watching this, you see in the paper that inflation has increased by X amount this month, or it's projected to be. So if you're watching that kind of thing and hear that, you should maybe now be thinking about that's going to impact bonds, and those bonds are going to impact mortgages. And related to the real world, if you're not locked in to a mortgage with a guy like Eric, then maybe you should be doing that, okay? So that's good information. Now, I hear that the central bank uses this thing called quantitative easing. Basically, they print money. Does that have any effect on mortgage rates?
Not necessarily. The more you print money, obviously the dollar goes down, which will play a factor into the economy per se. That will, in the long run, affect mortgage rates because the economy is going to be dictating that, a portion of dictating the rate. So offset a little bit, it's far back there, but it's got a certain say.
Okay. So there's just more than one factor involved in this. Gotcha.
Correct.
All right. So a number of years ago, there was this obscure office called the Office of the Superintendent of Financial Institutions. That really rolls off the tongue.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
The OFSI.
Yeah.
And they instituted a policy to put the brakes on, not the brakes, but to slow down the market. This is going back some years ago. So who is the OFSI, and how much of an impact do they have on mortgage rates, if any?
OFSI is somebody who regulates banks. Mortgage brokers or lenders, we are more regulated by FSRA. But the banks are very regulated by OFSI. OFSI is the ones that make sure that the policies are done, the compliances are done, and everybody abides by the mortgage rules. That's their main goal. Now, you know, they meet up with the Bank of Canada to sort of give them insights as to what's going on the market and what they're seeing. But I mean, OFSI doesn't really have a say in changing the rates. They can tell the Bank of Canada to change the rates all they want. The Bank of Canada will decide whether they do it or not.
Okay, so they're quite independent from the Bank of Canada.
Yeah. It's very more in the underwriting and the regulations and sort of the rules that they input in the mortgage world to prevent fraud, ideally, and to make sure that everybody is compliant and are in the mortgage market with integrity.
Oh, that's interesting. Okay. So we're kind of learning about who's involved and who's not involved. So in terms of involvement, could the finance minister pick up the phone and say, hey, Justin, this is Christie here. I think the mortgage market is getting overheated. I think housing prices are becoming unsustainable. So I'm going to bump up mortgage rates. What do you think? Does that make any kind of sense, or is that a bunch of nonsense? Yeah. Does the finance minister control rates in any way?
Yes, of course. You know, they're going to have their say with the Bank of Canada on what they choose to do. If they want to put a halt on the economy or slow it down and cool it off a little bit, for sure, they definitely have that say.
Oh, okay. That's interesting. A little bit of a different note here. In my business as a realtor, I'm occasionally meeting up with this a property whose financing is done by a MIC. What is a MIC?
Mortgage Investment Corporation, mainly done on the private side. We're sort of lucky in Ottawa because we have a few different options that we can go with. Even in our business, our company's actually started a MIC as well. So we have opportunities. Ideally, it's for people that don't qualify with normal lenders or normal banks. Whether it be that you're self-employed and you only declare a certain amount of income per year, your credit score is not there, you're missing a little bit of down payment. These corporations are a lender, a private lender, if you want, and are there to help exactly those people either get out of credit issues or just if you're not declaring enough income.
So as such, one would anticipate their rates would be higher than...
Higher rates, but they're not as bad. You would be looking at around 4.79, 4.99 right now on those rates, typically on a one-year term. When we bring you into a MIC, we as mortgage brokers want to make sure that there's an exit strategy and not just put you there and that you're going to be stuck there, you know, from years and years and years. We want to make sure there's an exit strategy so we can get you out of that MIC in 1 year and put you into normal banks.
Okay, good to know that there's alternatives.
Of course.
So when you do go with one of the big chartered banks, and let's say you take out a five-year term, you lock yourself into this mortgage, and then life happens to you, whatever it might be. It might be death, divorce, loss of employment, whatever, and you've got to get out of your mortgage. There's this thing called an IRD, interest rate differential.
Correct.
What is it? How bad can it be?
It could be pretty bad. That's, you know, that's a big term to say, what's the penalty to get out of my mortgage? There's a calculation out there that that banks use in order to calculate the penalty. It'll be, for example, if you have 3 years remaining on your term, and you had a rate before of 2.89, they would calculate whatever the discount that you received at the bank and whatever the rate is at that term. So 3 years remaining, it would be a three-year term minus your discount, and then that's how they would calculate the penalty. So, you know, it's sometimes, for argument's sake, if you have $330,000 remaining on your mortgage and you have 3 years remaining, it could cost you up to $12,000-$13,000 for a penalty.
That's significant. I've heard of them even being higher. Of course, it all depends on the total amount of the mortgage, of course, right?
Correct.
And if it's 3 years or 2 years or whatever.
Correct. But sometimes on those types of calculation, it actually comes in benefiting the client, even though the, let's say right now your rate was at 3.34, which is what was offered 3 years ago, and now you can get a rate of 1.99, sometimes paying the penalty will save you in the long run, because you're getting a better interest rate, you're going to be saving an interest for the next 5 years, and that $13,000 that you've paid, mm-hmm. you've saved over $20,000. So sometimes it makes sense to mm-hmm. look at it a different way, but yeah, that's what the RRD is there for.
That's interesting. It is all dependent on the math. Just doing some factual calculations, and somebody goes to someone knowledgeable like yourself, you can do that math for them and provide them with better advice.
For sure.
Okay, cool. So a last question I have about this financial stuff is, we hear the term fixed versus variable mortgages all the time. So if I get a variable mortgage, is it just a variable, or is it like a variable 2 year or a variable 5 year? And what's a 5 year variable? Why is that different than a 5 year fixed?
Okay, so the variable term will fluctuate. A lot of times we get fixated on the actual rate that you're receiving with the variable rate, where we have to focus on the discount that you're receiving from the prime rate. A variable rate will always be, you know, prime, which is 2.45 right now, will be less than 1%, okay? So that discount is really what's gonna be the main thing that you wanna look at. When the Bank of Canada decides to up their rates, obviously the rates will go up, and then you're gonna discount that 1% to whatever the prime rate would be at that time. So your mortgage payments can fluctuate as you move forward into your five-year term. Typically, the variable rates will always be lower than the fixed rate because it's a higher risk. The penalty, so IRD on the variable term, is only 3 months' interest.
Oh, terrific.
So higher risk, mm-hmm. easier to get out of the mortgage, not as much cost. On the five-year fix, peace of mind. You're guaranteed to have that that interest rate for the duration of the 5 year. And again, if you want to get out of that mortgage, the penalties will be a little higher.
Okay, so if somebody's not sure and think that they may be selling in 12 to 18 months, a variable might be better for them because their risk is reduced.
Exactly. Moving, relocating, anything that in that regards, you're going to have the variable rate will be more attractive to that type of client for sure.
Excellent. Okay. I'm all out of questions unless you had something that you wanted to add to the discussion.
No, your questions were really good. It's good for me.
Okay. So this is Patrick Walchuk and Eric Fabien of OttawaMortgageShop.com. Thank you.